libertarian communist. The word libertarian, by the way, was made up by anarchists in France back in the 1890s and has been picked up by proprietarians who use the word libertarian to signify their pure capitalist beliefs.
Bill Buckley, for example.
Yes. Well, even Ronald Reagan said, "I sort of think you'd call me a libertarian." It was actually, the word was made up in 1890 in France by Élisée Reclus, who was one of Bakunin, Michael Bakunin's closest associates, because the word anarchist, used in France in the 1890s as a result of terrorist attacks, was declared virtually illegal. So they had to find another word for it. Since then, it's been mutating its way into the right wing for the most preposterous, on the most preposterous basis. But very significantly, to go back to what I was trying to say, is that Parenti identifies my opposition to his Stalinoid type of views as being anti-communist. I find that intriguing. I find that a very totalitarian way of characterizing other people's ideas. And that's what I really want to turn to. And this is not an ad hominem criticism. Just as the Stalinists in the 1930s, who had totally betrayed the revolution, of course, without knowing it in some cases as rank and file, and consciously knowing it in the case of Stalin, Molotov, and the rest of his gang, called everyone who opposed them a fascist, or at least people on the left who opposed them as fascist. I find it very disturbing, that a Parenti, one Michael Parenti, can call people who disagree with his in my opinion, very totalitarian view of communism as anti-communist. I mean, this is, if you don't mind my saying this, a kind of rather disturbing inversion. And I have encountered this all over the place, by the way, in other respects. I've criticized people like Ed Abbey and certain members, leaders of Earth First, as being anti-Earth First, number one, because I criticized them, not Earth First. And secondly, and this has been repeated even on academic periodicals, that I called Earth First eco-fascist. Whereas in point of fact, I talked about the dangers of eco-fascism as a result of certain statements made by people like Edward Abbey, who declared, one, that the United States is a northern European culture, read Aryan, that Hebrew superstitions are responsible for the ecological crisis ideologically, read anti-Semite, okay, that three, Mexicans should be shoved back across the border, okay, and continual racist remarks, and, by the way, misogynist remarks, addressing me, incidentally, as a, quote, fat old woman, if that's the worst possible thing I could be if I were one. You know, his major epithet. Now, when I designated him as an eco-fascist or potential eco-fascist, you must understand that, like Parenti, these totalitarian types, no matter what they call themselves, or libertarian types, to use a true, what is now becoming current, although grossly distorted, right-wing language, these really totalitarian types in the way they argue distorted everything I had to say and claimed that I was accusing Earth First, a movement that I in fact supported as best I could, you see, and with whose ideas I in great part agreed with, provided they didn't get messed up with this whole idea that people are a cancer on the planet, which is what some of their leaders or founders said. They accused me of accusing Earth First and accusing deep ecology of being eco-fascist. This is the way I did. And by the way, the people who made these accusations, you know, the other flip side of Parenti's coin, those people who made these accusations against me were university professors. They were university professors. And they were writing in the literature, the, you know, the exotic academic literature on environmental science, environmental politics, whatever you like. So what shocks me more than Parenti's very selective way of hearing what I had to say, I who have been condemning capitalism, and hence presumably managed somehow not to believe in a class society, this selective way of hearing is not simply a feature of an alleged militant, a neo-Bolshevik like Parenti, who, by the way, even a Lenin would be ashamed of, considering some of his crudities. I find that to be a very common phenomenon today, as part of the complete cultural degradation and moral degradation of discourse today. And if I seem heated about it, it's because I'm deeply concerned about the ethical probity of what would be a left-wing movement. If to disagree with Parenti's version of communism is to be anti-communist, I find that to be a purely arrogant remark, even if I were to say that there are no classes and only people, which is an absurd statement in the first place. I never said any such statement. I talked about the idea that ultimately we must appeal to humanity as a whole and not simply to the working class. And this is the way it comes out, mutated through that computer that calls itself Michael Parenti.
I would like to go...
Do you like that answer or you don't? It's a generalization that has to be drawn there.
Sure. I would like to go back to the beginning of your discussion. Two events in history that had a profound impact on you and on history. One that's received enormous coverage, one that has been somewhat forgotten. The Bolshevik Revolution and the Spanish Revolution. Two questions. Why is the Bolshevik Revolution given such coverage as compared to the Spanish Revolution? And then to compare and contrast the two. As I see the Bolshevik Revolution, they in part destroyed the anarchist movements in Russia at the time. Yes?
Well, of course, yes, they did destroy the anarchist movement. Although there are strange stories about this thing that have never been clarified, and I believe in truth above any other tactical or polemical goal. The Russian Revolution obviously received the greatest amount of attention because, first of all, it occurred on the eve of what seemed like world revolutions. October, to use the old Russian date, or November, to use our contemporary Russian American dates and way of dating, and perhaps even, for that matter, the Russian today. October 1917 shook the whole world. It was 10 days, as John Reed so dramatically put it, that shook the whole world. Nobody quite knew what the Bolsheviks were up to. Nobody knew who Lenin was. When finally red flags began to replace the traditional Russian Republican flag, not to speak of the Tsarist one, when at length Lenin and the Bolsheviks made appeals to all the workers of the world to turn the imperialist war into a civil war, when in fact one of the most extraordinary propaganda machines, so much in contrast, by the way, to Stalin, made an appeal to all the oppressed to rise up. The Russian Revolution, Bolshevik Revolution more precisely, was indeed a threat to world capitalism. Engaged in the midst of a war that was yet to continue for a full year after the Bolsheviks took power, it must be seen that the Russian Revolution was indeed a threat to world capitalism. It might have easily gotten out of the control of the Bolsheviks had revolutions occurred elsewhere in Europe. Thus had Rosa Luxemburg and Karl Liebknecht succeeded in January of 1919 in turning Germany into a Soviet republic, and Luxemburg's ideas were extremely libertarian, by the way. There's a whole gray zone in which it's not at all clear where the anarchist called Luxemburg comes to an end and the Marxist called Luxemburg begins. And had Gustav Landauer and the people around him, or the people whom he worked with, established a solid Bavarian Soviet Republic, and many of them were anarchists. Landauer himself was at least very closely akin to the anarchists and left the Second International, the Socialist International, because they refused to accept anarchists, the Russian Revolution might have easily gotten out of the control of Lenin, whatever his ideas may have been, and moved into a much more, and I use this in a leftist sense, libertarian revolution.